is remembering that this is not a dress rehearsal, this is your life. And work consumes an amazing percentage of the hours that you'll spend alive on this planet and this incarnation at least. And because you're all going to have a lot of impact on other folks, that means you're going to have a huge impact on all those hours of life that other people spend. And not reminding yourself of that can lead you to define success in an incredibly minimalist way, and not reach the full potential of your life. There's some woman named Colette once said, I had a wonderful life, I only wish I'd realized it sooner. Next please. Yeah, so, in thinking about that, I could cover innovation, but I'm not. If you want to cover some of that in Q&A, we can. But I'm going to talk about two of the things for achieving success, but vision and mission, and then leadership. I'll talk about those in turn. The tough thing with vision and mission is, and the bigger the organization, the tougher is to achieve clarity, sort of clarity and credibility, that the words on the wall are not just words on the wall, but actually stand for something, guide decisions, guide behavior. Easy to say, tougher to do, particularly for us. We started in a sloppy situation with about 10,000 human beings, and we now have 35,000, spread across about 2,000 locations. So the sheer sort of marketing communication challenge, the challenge of building an authentic vision, mission, and set of core values across that bigger group is formidable, because a lot of hands-on caregivers, they don't all have an email, they don't all have a phone extension, you don't get to call them into a room, you can't have them all leave the floor and go get on a speakerphone, so it's very different than having 2,000 people in one location. Many of our folks have never been to college, so we face the situation of, gee, how do we create an authentic, incredible, and clear vision and mission set of core values in that real-world environment? Go ahead and hit next, please. So for us, this is our vision circle. At the very core is for us to be a village. My title is mayor. When I get emails from the field, it goes to KT, the mayor. That's the metaphor we use for making decisions. It doesn't mean that you just suspend the demands of capitalism, because if you ever talk to someone who actually runs a city, you care a lot about the economy of that city. If it is not sustainable, you can't have good schools, you can't have good parks, you can't have a good police force, etc. And citizens get that, but they want for the tax that they pay to a community, for the tax you pay as profit to shareholders, that be a fair exchange, a transparent, fair, accountable exchange. So at the very core of our vision is to be a community first and a company second. Next. That community has a purpose, which is to create the greatest dialysis company the world has ever seen. 11 years ago, when we started all this, and the situation was what Israel described, when we first said those words, in a room like this, with a group about this size, in fact, the first time I called together the group of all the regional field folks, so this is actually relatively comparable, put those words up, we're going to build the greatest dialysis company the world's ever seen, we're functionally bankrupt, being sued by shareholders, most of the execs have been quit or fired, the stock had got to $1.40, turnover was couldn't even be tracked at first, it was very high. You can imagine the skepticism in the room. Now, I'll get hundreds of emails a year where people refer to Grace Dawson's company the world has ever seen. They would be learning to write songs about it. And in fact, we are. And no one, there is no other dialysis organization in the world that has a set of both conventional clinical outcomes and innovative new actions and policies and practices that drive more clinical value. So that's the purpose of the community. Next. And then beyond that, we want to be a role model for American healthcare. So when these words were first used, maybe about a year after greatest dialysis company the world ever seen, a year or two, once again, most of the executives at that point, they said, okay, we made this greatest dialysis company thing, we've gotten used to that, and we're sort of into it. This village thing, all right, we're getting comfortable with what that means. But now, you want to step too far, role model for American healthcare. Now if you go to the United States Senate or the House of Representatives in Washington, D.C., or certain people at CMS, they both cite DaVita as a role model in several dimensions for the way in which they wish other companies to behave and lead their sectors to behave as responsible citizens of the broader American healthcare community. And then, going even further, this one again, after rolling eyes a couple of years later, we added the fourth one, which is the Center for Principles of Citizen Leadership, that by how we behave makes a difference in the lives of our people and their communities, and then ultimately the world, because of how they behave differently and lead differently after they leave us than they would have had they not been with us. So this is our vision circle. These phrases all get used by thousands of people every whole series of elections, and the people chose the logo. The one thing they didn't choose was the mission. I chose the mission. It wasn't subject to debate, and then shortly after I got there, the idea of the mission was to be simple so people could remember it, and that every year, every single one of our teammates could do their own grading of whether or not we were pursuing authentically and effectively the mission, that whether or not we were the provider of choice in their community, whether or not we were the partner of choice for other entities, and whether or not we were the employer of choice. They could grade both their local unit and the company and call us on it when the words weren't true. And we could call them on whether or not they were taking shared ownership for making the words come true. Now, there's a bunch of pitter-patter. What else might one do? You're all going to be out there leading companies, leading divisions, leading operations, leading initiatives. So what do you do when you walk into something and there ain't nothing special going on in terms of mission or vision or core values? It isn't totally average. Totally competent capitalistically, but totally average organization. So how do you think about creating something which is systematically different? Because we all know certain people who are very service-oriented, service excellence, one of our core values. You all know some people who have much higher integrity, their second core value. You all know some people who are way more team-oriented than others, and teams that are more effective, that's a third core value. You all know some people who are much more continuous improvement-oriented, accountability, fulfillment, fun. These are all our core values. We all know people. If you look at that, you go, oh yeah, this family is way more this way, this team is way more this way, this individual is this way. And then somehow they end up saying, oh, but large organizations sort of regress to the mean. And that's total BS. They regress to the mean because people give up. And there's no reason why a large company or a complicated organization or initiative can't be as different from average ones than a person or a small team. As long as you work at it. And so we rejected the premise that getting big and decentralized and distributed means you can't be differentiated in terms of human behavior. Greg, which one? Pardon? And one of the other ways that we try to achieve, clarity about our mission is to talk about it. It saves our core values. We not only talk about these things, we actually sing about them sometimes. Go ahead. Next, please. And so, every single team, of course, around this idea, which in part means I gotta think about it and talk about it, so I get all that reinforcement from the person doing the interview. And also if you say, you know what, this person's technically competent, but they're in a bone in their body that gets excited about some of this core value stuff, whether I'm saying it explicitly or implicitly. So next one's in addition, every single executive, so this is an actual form from a CFO interview. I'm KT, so that's me up there, and then Joe Bellow is the COO, Gary Biles, the controller. This is the actual form filling out the evaluation for a CFO candidate. We score every executive we hire on every one of the core values to see whether or not we go, well, this person, they don't even use the same words, but it's very clear they try to live their life according to some of these things, or quite the opposite. And you can see at the bottom that the CFO candidate was not fun. This too was not a good score, and he was not hired in part because he was zero fun. So recruiting is heavily informed, and so many organizations miss this. And if you're starting to bring in, you got some turnover and some growth, and you're adding 20% new people a year, and you don't think about your mission and core values when you're doing that, oh my God, what an anchor to put on whatever efforts you have, sincere efforts you have, to try to create a differentiated work environment. What sense that they say, I want to have a great basketball team, but the new players I bring in every year, I'm not going to screen for basketball talent. It makes no sense. Well, it doesn't make any sense for companies either not to emphasize this recruiting. On to review. So it starts with me. I get scored every single year on every one of the core values and the three components of our mission, and the scores go to the board of directors, and I don't get to change them. And they also get shared with all my direct reports. So when I'm not walking the talk, I got to face up to it in public and with my bosses. Now, some of you behave virtuously every day without this kind of help. I'm not in that category. So I need this kind of oversight in order to help me remember to not use an excuse today for being a jerk to someone, for not being unfair to someone because I've had a tough week. That I can slip into those bad behaviors absent a system that helps remind me that I'll be held accountable when I do, even though I'm everybody's boss. Next. Which one?
As has always been the case, the tradition is that Joe and I.
This is one of the other things I think needs to contemplate. So every year, I get in front of 2,500 people, our top 2,500 leaders come together, gets a room like this only bigger, and every year, the first thing we do is talk about how I underperformed in the prior year, or my COO and I. Because how can I possibly talk about where the enterprise underperformed, or have people reflect on what they did, where they failed, if I don't start with my own? And a lot of leaders can't handle this. And I was going to say, do you actually think a lot of people don't know about your failures? That's not the issue. The issue is they're wondering whether or not you know you failed. And it's actually very reassuring when someone can get up and use the same words to describe their own failure that the people are using in their head when they watch you dance up on a stage.
As has always been the case, tradition of these meetings is that Joe and I have talked about the areas where we underperformed in the past year since we were last together. It's never a particularly fun part of the presentation for me. But it's important first to say that this is KTJM underperformance. Okay? It doesn't mean the people in these teams are.
That's good. So you just we go through it every single year, and it's really bad when I have to put the same bullet point up 2 years in a row. But that's how we start the annual State of the Village. At the annual Village Leadership Meeting. And then every single review that I do for my direct reports, the first section is the most important message that happens to me. The second section is the mission and values. And so I have an actual live conversation, this is an actual forum, that will rank. So I'm sitting here with Tom Smith. I say, Tom, with respect to integrity, you're kind of to get as much as you can out of that meeting. Nevertheless, we take a block of time in that meeting. If we were doing it here, you'd all have the mission values report card in front of you on the table, and you grade yourself, and then write comments to yourself. We just force that contemplative time, where, and then you can sit there and say, well, all right, you know, you kind of go, I'm going to lie to myself. So I want to kind of exaggerate, and then we suggest we to talk around the table with some other people about your highest score and your lowest score. And try it sometime, according to whatever core values you've established for your own life, personally or professionally. We have people who've kept these for years and refer back year by year by year, and promotes a lot of good discussions. Because how can you say something's really important as a leader and then not reflect rigorously on it? It makes no sense. Like I said, I care about my family, but I'm not going to think about how to live in a place where we have good schools and how to create an environment that's safe around the home and create family traditions so we get together. You do all that because you're living that. You're thinking about it rigorously because you know family's very important to you. And then you say core values are important to you and your job is a leader in your organization, and you never do the same sort of reflective rigor and translate it into action and monitoring and explicit nuances of where you're strong and weak. So that's review. On to reinforce. So important, it gets back to that Buddhist quote, it's important to be mindful. It's easy to be mindful, it's hard to remember to be mindful. So we do a lot of stuff to try to remind you. Think about it. Why do people go to church? A lot of people go to church in America. Again, it's the same songs, it's the same chants. After a while, it's the same sermons, it's a rotation. Why do you go? To be reminded. A lot of us, we just step back and be reminded. And a lot of stuff we do is around helping people remember. A triple crown. Well, one of the things we say to our people, if you're a community, first and the company second, when the profits are strong, the profits are shared. So we've done more profit sharing with frontline teammates than any other healthcare service company in America. We've been saying this now for about 8 years. Never had anybody submit any data to show that there's anyone in our league. Maybe there is, but then we'd only be in the 90th percentile instead of the 100th. Because if you believe in being a community first or company second, you share with your citizens when times are good. How else do you expect them to share the hardship when times are bad without counterproductive complaining? It's got to work on both sides. And so many capitalistic enterprises in America have forgotten this basic fact. About making that fundamental ethical decision of, are they part of the team or not? Are they just employed or are they part of your team? And that's just not a rhetorical question. That the answer to that question is reflected in your actions, not your words. And so we have this extensive profit sharing, which has one part which is called the Village Award, which everyone gets if it's a good year. So sort of like in the village, making sure if there's enough food, everybody gets to eat. Then there's the Victory Award, which says for the people who achieve good goals, they get extra money. So it's like, okay, the farms that produce the most food for the village, they should get more money because everybody benefited from what they did. That's the victory part. And then there's the value part, which is very different. We don't know any other company that does this. Let's say you work for me and you've got 30 people. And this year, you get to pick one out of five. Not because they're great business performers, although I doubt that people are picked if they're on probation. Not because they're picked because they're role models for our mission and values. They're the kind of people who make the team feel different, make the day feel different. They're the kind of people where the meeting goes better when they're in it because everyone else behaves a little better because they're nice, they're considerate, they're honest, they're thoughtful, they're accountable, they live our core values, and they get a bonus. Right? And with a letter, they're called into a room, and with this very small number of people, the letter, which is from the mayor and the COO, is read to them, honoring them for being distinctive human beings in a world filled with as much pressure for them as it is for every other adult that works there. Yet they're one of those people who just behaves with more thoughtfulness and humanity, and they give it a check. And so we want to honor the fact that you're a distinctive human being. And we don't just do this a little bit. This is how much money we give away, tied to the top category, literally people living our core values, and the bottom category fits into that other element of sort of conceptual community behavior, the sharing. But we've had distinctively good years. We've taken people who make $72,000 a year, and their typical bonus can be up to 15% of that. Right? So let's say they get two-thirds of it in a typical year, that's $10,000. Right? So it's somebody making $72,000 salary, $10,000 bonus, and prosperity awards. When we have a good year, executives are getting the exercise options and the rest, then we'll hand that person a $25,000 check. They had never received a $25,000 check in their life. They may never again receive a $25,000 check. And they get it as our way of sharing prosperity for some of the, in this case, high business performers. So you have both the yin and the yang. So it's a serious money over time. And this is just since 2005, just because some of our record keeping wasn't so good in the years before then. Next. And we also get the patients engaged. Because one defined it as a community, and you happen to be in healthcare service, although we would do this in any businesses that we were in. But I think that the patients, co-owners, of whether or not that clinic feels like a community or just feels like a sterile medical unit. And so one of the things we do is the patients vote and comment on their caregivers. And so the Shining Star caregivers pick once or twice a year in centers across America. With no greater honor for a caregiver than to be honored by patients with a little ceremony. But the other thing we did is every single comment about every caregiver gets read. And this happens right out on the floor. And so the patients that are on that shift get to hear their comments and the comments of other patients being read out loud. And every single caregiver, or when they won the quote-unquote prize, the top honor, doesn't matter, gets to hear that beauty of another human being saying, you're kind to me. You take great care of me. You're a dedicated clinician. And no greater gift than that. Doesn't happen in a lot of healthcare. It doesn't happen in a lot of companies very often. The whole thing about saying thank you for being a special performer, thank you for being a kind human being, doesn't happen a lot. It doesn't make sense. Next. Which one? If you can talk a little about it.
Yes.
Thank you. Ah, we also reinforce these values. Actually, the people did this on their own, and are reinforcing our values in other ways, which are more festive. And that, you need to know that because that's not what this company's about. I get these regularly, which of course is bad because it means sometimes very unhappy and sometimes they're right and sometimes they're wrong. But the beauty is that's the only clinic they ever worked in. And it was mocked up in their mind. That didn't change their view that the company actually stood for this stuff. Right? That the messaging to them was authentic, even though in their mind the only clinic that they've ever worked in was a violation, that they've seen enough other evidence to believe that the enterprise actually holds themselves to that standard. And therefore it mattered. So let me, Casey, I just got one of these literally last night. You need to know that this clinic is focused. I quit. This was from a nurse. I quit. But you need to know because I know you would want to fix this place for other caregivers, even though that's the only place she ever worked. Next. Then we also do things like we communicate. You think about a vasculature. Your body can't survive without a vasculature, so the blood can carry everything that it carries around. And some people have healthy minds and some people have poor ones. Communication is like the vasculature of a company. And sometimes a healthy vasculature can communicate more than some don't. We do things like we call the voice of the notes call every 8 weeks. I get on the phone with the COO, the chief medical officer. We get about 3,000 people on the phone. Clinics across America, and there'd be six people around speakerphone where we can do it in the major neighborhoods. There'd be a couple hundred people in the cafeteria or whatever. And we give it up to the company, and then any single person can ask any question they want. And then the other 2,999 people get to listen to the answer. One investment banker said we are the biggest small company in America. We like that. We like to keep it that way. Just like if you were mayor of a village, what was part of your job is to talk and maintain that two-way communication. You and the city council, so many companies, that's lost. Why? Because they don't have that metaphor. A company can be much more hierarchical, much more top-down, much more filtered. That's not how a community behaves. A community behaves much more transparent, fluent, two-way communication. Therefore, we do. And we have a rule on this because an executive bops around anytime you're in any place, and there's more than eight teammates, and of course, I'm sure this is not true all the time, it's your responsibility to do a town hall. We call together those teammates and ask them any question, and then you can't answer, you commit to getting back to them, you get back to them. It's funny sometimes when you ask leaders about what's their communication style, that in the answer, some of it's being 80-100% of the answer. It talks about how they speak, how they communicate out. And for a leader, right, half your answer should be about how you collect and listen. Right? But they don't think of that when they're asked the question. Next. Then revere. Next, please. One of the things that we say is that community produces most what it honors most. And so if you honor profit above all else, the good news is you're much more likely to get a lot of profit. The bad news is you probably end up with not a very fulfilled life and not a very differentiated work environment. And so while we reward profit big time, you get a big bonus, you get a raise, you get a big equity grant, while we reward that, we don't honor it. Instead, at all levels of our organization, we try to honor leadership, human leadership, and business performance is just a subset of that. And we take honoring very seriously because we believe this is true. I struck an example with our facility administrators, the people who run our dialysis clinics, give you a sense of what it's like when we honor them.
What about the special night of the year, the life of our village, the village, the night of honor?
This is for everyone back in Napa. Without all of them, this wouldn't be possible. One for all and all for one.
I'm true blue to be there. My husband said, when we turned our bedroom to blue and yellow, that I kind of
I definitely hang this proudly in my facility. Thank you.
After having been in dialysis for 28 years, we've truly found a home and a family with Davina.
Thank you, Davina, for being the kind of company that allows me to grow both personally and professionally.
At the help desk, we don't have a way of touching the patients. We have to do that for you guys. And the least I can do is thank everybody in this room that does that.
I'm so proud to now be a part of Davina. I've never ever experienced anything like this. It's absolutely amazing. Thank you. Thank you.
So think about when you're running something, a team, an organization, an initiative, what do you honor? And how often do you honor it? And with what seriousness do you honor it? That will go a long way towards driving the fundamental culture and values of the enterprise that you're associated with. Next, please. This is our wall of honor. We have an annual executive retreat just like everyone else. There are no awards given for business performance at an annual executive retreat. The sacred night of honor, everybody gets all dressed up, is when for each of our core values, we pick the executive who's the best role model for one of those and have a very formal nominating process. And then we actually, the night is videoed. And so the winners, you get mommies and daddies who get to go home and call their kids into the family room, their spouse, and say, yeah, I get to show you a video where I just awarded a core value award for integrity or team. And they hear the nominating speech. They see the standing ovation they get. No greater gift that we give to a mommy or daddy than they go home and show that video to their kids. An example of eliminating this false distinction between a professional life and a personal life. So, first talk about the facility administrators. That was that first group being honored. Then the second, the senior executive ranks. And then the final clip I'll show here is our frontline teammates, whom we have honored for their mission value performance. Jay, please.
Is it?
of true dedication on the spiritual side. So we, and at the beginning, we don't want to concede for a moment that we should be less of a team-oriented, enthusiastic as a sports team, that we should be less committed to our mission than the military and less loyal to each other, or less spiritually thoughtful than someone in a religion. So in our minds, we're totally normal because we behave like the organizations we want to be like, and most companies have become ethically and morally sterile. The video, please.
Good be done!
And say, okay, I don't know how the hell we're going to get up to the top of that mountain. but we're going to give it a try. And the way you start trying is taking a step or two next. And so, for example, in caring for our patients, we don't want to just do great clinical work. We want to create a compassionate environment with a sense of shared ownership. I talk about the Shining Star Caregiver. We also do a Tour de Vida bike ride each year. We just did 250 miles, 400 caregivers from across America, raising $750,000 to fight kidney disease. We have a number of other programs where patients are encouraged to write letters to their physicians. No greater gift from the patient, to the patient actually, who is the giver, because they get more engagement to the doctor. How often do they get thank you notes? Well, the Vita, thousands of times a year. Next. Caring for each other, the Vita Village Network and a community. If a neighbor loses a spouse or a spouse gets cancer, the house burns down, the neighbors help. But in a lot of parts of America, that safety net doesn't work anymore. But if the Vita does, we'll be strung together all the neighborhoods across America into a village network where we step in and are the safety net when tragedy strikes. Next. And then just one example from caring for the world, we do medical missions overseas. Teammates donating their time and us donating some in-kind consideration and bringing dialysis to places where people otherwise die. The number of volunteers who want to participate in this always vastly exceeds the number of spots and expression of how much people would like. If organizations like the ones you're going to run and work in and lead create the opportunity, people will flock to give back. It's our job to create mechanisms and systems and processes and opportunities that make that possible. Next. So if you go back, we were just a regular company back this time. Step by step, we added a whole bunch of things. Next, please. And in fact, we had more time. I could go through the other 25 to 30 village programs. Things that a company wouldn't necessarily do, but a community would, as a matter of course. I just gave you one other example. We had a woman whose husband had kidney cancer, and she went in because she wanted to see if she could donate her kidney to save him. When she went in, she found out she had ovarian cancer. They both died within a relatively short period of time and close to each other. They had a daughter. The daughter was going to have to drop out of college in order to pay for the funeral expenses. No, that person was never going back to work. She was dead. So the company might very well say, well, this is a tragedy, but so we're sort of done with it. This is just a regular team that's not an executive or anything. But in a community, you would never let that happen. A child from a neighbor you care about. So we stepped in, we provided the money for a scholarship to keep her in college, we took care of the funeral. We hired the attorney because the uncle that was otherwise going to manage the trust was not trustworthy in terms of how that would happen. We took care of that child in the way a community would, and the way many companies would not. Just one example of living the metaphor. Next. I'm going to quickly cover some sort of leadership points. All that was to sort of talk about if one goes into whatever you're going to go into with a sense of purpose, then, boy, if you really want to go at it in the same way, if you wanted to build a lot of market share or have awesome clinical outcomes, you'd have a plan, you'd actually go out with a plan, you'd persevere, you'd be tenacious, you'd take some risks. Well, building a differentiated work environment, a place where people care about each other with more consistency and tenacity, it takes that same kind of steadfast stuff. So we just walked through a whole bunch of the things one might do to actually create something quite different cumulatively. To do that, though, you also need to think about leadership and your leadership. And so I'm going to go through a sort of maker's dozen of leadership points. Next, please. First, the famous philosopher, John Mellencamp, said, one of the most important things in life is to figure out what the most important things in your life are. And then, what we add to his statement is then to make sure you reflect every now and then whether or not the way you're allocating your time, money, and energy is consistent with what you said was most important. Next. Just as beauty is in the eyes of the beholder, leadership is in the eyes of the lad. It literally doesn't matter one bit what kind of leader you think you are. Whatever you're going through your brain right now, what kind of leader you are, doesn't matter. If you don't know how other people experience you as a leader, then you are not one. And if you can't use exactly the words that they would use to describe some of your characteristics, less than inspirational, and you can't say them out loud in a room like this, then you're not really a leader. You might be a great narrow sort of leader tied to creating a business objective, but you're not a life leader. Next. People don't care what you know until they know how much you care. And an awful lot of folks in for-profit and not-for-profit have forgotten this one. Next. Management is a have a true sense of ownership in both the business objective and the life objective tied to all those hours. Next. Spiritual practice, I'm going to Buddhist thing. Spiritual practice is what you're doing right now. It doesn't matter what you do it in giving a speech. It doesn't matter what words you put into a song. That in the end, the path of leadership is established step by step by step by all the little things you do every day. In the same sense that spiritual behavior is what you are spiritually, not what religion you are, not how often you go to church. It's how you behave in all the little ways all day long. Next. Company produces most, what honors most, so think a lot about what, in fact, in your life, especially personally, you honor, how thoughtfully, how intensely, and how often. Eight. Do you track karma? Well, you track expenses. When I talked to some executives who said, we really care about cultural stuff, and I said, well, gosh, do you track labor productivity every month? And they go, yeah. And that's a dumb question. Do you track revenue? And they go, yeah. And why, you really ask a lot of dumb questions. And then I say, okay, and you say, people are your most important asset, you really care about it. So, how do you track and monitor and innovate around your culture and around your core values? And then just stop. Well, you can't, it's different. You say, well, okay, it's different, that I grant you. But if it's so important, how could you ever not assess with rigor and regularity what's going on? That's something so important. That's why you regress to the if you're serious, some people are serious about marketing, or serious about healthcare service, or serious about consumer retail, what do? You look for, go work at a place where they're really good at it, where they care about it, where they talk about it, where they study it, where they reflect on it, where they kind of, they intensely invest in being the best at it. That's what you would do. It's a no-brainer. Then you got other people say, yeah, I want to be a leader. And they don't think about, and I'm going to be a leader in creating an environment that has differential core values, a different sense of mutual emotional engagement. And then you talk about where they're going to work, and that's not one of the criteria. You say, well, you know, learning about this stuff is no less intense. And it's no less important. There's no less of a journey than becoming a great marketer. You know, you're going to be a great basketball player. You're going to miss where great basketball is playing, where they practice hard. So leadership is like that. That if you don't go someplace and work with people who honor it by virtue of the intensity with which they bring to it, how, for instance, in the life charity, then you're going to be learning from people who aren't very good at it. I'm very serious about it. Next. Speak your dreams. If you're in town and you want to try to climb a mountain, there's a mountain outside the village, and you just say, I don't want to tell people because you're not sure you can make it. So you say, hey, friends, I'm going to go for a good long hike. And you're thinking, you know, I might climb that mountain if I'd be able to come back and tell everybody. And it gets cold, and you're tired, and then you turn back and you say, phew, I'm glad I didn't say. Very different. You tell people, I'm going to climb that mountain. Then you get equally cold, equally tired, but you don't turn back because you said it out loud. Most people want to live up to what they say. Leadership is a lot like that. If you don't speak your dream about how you want to try to behave with all your imperfections, about how you would like that organization to feel for the human beings, the impact you'd like to have on the world, separate from achieving business objectives, then you're almost certainly not going to do it. Because it's really hard. All those real-life pressures really squeeze it out. And on the margin, you're not going to do as much unless you say it out loud. Because if you didn't say it out loud, it's easier to go, oh my God, not this week. I'm not going to recognize this week. My wife's mind mad at me. My kid's sick. I get an unfair project deadline. It goes unless you say it out loud. So speak your dreams. Otherwise, the odds that they come true are much reduced. Important that you hear, important that others hear. Most of us have faults. I have more than most. But one thing I've learned with all my personal weaknesses is that intentionality rules. People can smell your intentionality. There were a lot of times in the early years in particular where some of this pitter patter was quite radical. Where then I would behave badly or perform badly. And so you go, my God, that cuts into the very credibility of all this pitter patter. But enough people said, you know what, he did screw up on that. But I bought off on his intentionality. And I'm still on board. Because in the end, it's not about the leader, it's about the leader creating other leaders and people who share that ownership. trying to be a life leader is very intense because of all the real world pressures that everybody knows about. And so, unless you refill your petzo, Buddha said, one cannot pour from an empty cup. So, unless you figure out ways to keep your sort of spiritual cup full, and not in a religious sense, but keep yourself healthy and keep your people healthy, it gets much tougher to do all of this. Unless life is living robustly within you, then it's difficult to make life live robustly within your work environment. Thanks. And the final one, begin with the end in mind. So you're going to be off doing things, or you're doing things right now. If you can't articulate, someone says, well, what is the dream for what you'd like your work environment to be like 5 years from now? If you can't articulate that in a relatively clear way, where a person could write it down, and then 5 years later talk about why not you nailed it, then you probably not going to do impressive things. Because you haven't defined with enough specificity the ambitious, the audacious goal around success. And therefore it's much, much less likely that you get there. Because doing this stuff is really hard. It takes a lot of tenacity, continued innovation, creativity, is a lot of failures and setbacks. And so unless you articulate great specificity, it's less likely to happen. Next. And this is my final slide. That in the end, it was Thich Nhat Hanh, a Buddhist monk, goes back to the speeches like this don't mean anything, right? And unless, of course, in this case, it's part for us, an expression of our personal mission, setting forth the rules of citizen leadership. So we do speaking engagements in places here. It actually makes recruiting sense because we hope a bunch of you consider working for us. We go to do other things where there's no recruiting value for us because it's a part of our making that force ring true, setting forth ripples of citizen leadership. So in the end, what it really speaks is how you live your life, not the words you use to express it. That's it. Thank you very much.
Philosophical and idea sharing exchange.
and they're a vital part of some of our stuff. Is that responsive?
Yeah, totally. I guess I had a fault. Follow-up question was, how would, I guess, being part of the startup, we think we could be a great teammate for Davida. How could I go about learning more about what you guys do to see if we could do that?
If I flip me an email, and it may take a while, but sure, you'll get forwarded to someone and you'll get responded to.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Very opportunistic.
Hello.
My name is Joel Decker. I have the potential to step into a company that started about 20 years ago that possesses a lot of values that you talk about, but has no sense of ownership among the sort of rank and file, anyone under management. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the transition that took place when you stepped into the company, how you got people to take ownership from a company that was sort of starting to, or not just starting to, but it drifted, and how that transition looked as you got them to take ownership of what you profess.
Yeah, the big question. I think in the end, one must ask really fundamental questions and force the answers to be discussed out loud. So if you have a team of executives, pretty good values, but they haven't really taken on the challenge of having that made manifest in a much more pervasive way, that you want to get in a room and in the right setting and ask very fundamental questions. You guys are an impressive group of people, and it seems like these core values are pretty strongly. What do you think about trying to have them a little more strongly, more broadly in the organization? Is that would be a good thing or a bad thing? Because they are your core values. So and have people talk about it, because everybody needs to go through that personal epiphany. We call it crossing the bridge of the meter, where you say, okay, it's not a dress rehearsal, this is my life, and I actually want to try to have a broader impact on the world and the people that work with me in this way. But you can't preach it to them. You can't just give a lecture. It's got to be in a conversation where they reflect. And some will say, I'm just fine with work the way it is. This is just working just great. My life is perfect. And if you have too many folks at that point of view and don't change it, you're not going to hold it off. But what tends to happen is you get some people who say, well, we could do more. And they think that you're probably a naive young man, and they think, well, we could do more. And then they start to do more, and they see the reaction that human beings have. And you go, wow, I really do believe in this value, and you really can make a difference. And that felt good and did good. And so you can't, you've got to be careful about you need to aggressively pursue small steps.
Thank you.
And I'd say one other thing too. And you got to make sure people are going to be patient, because some things are going to fail. Some things, you say them to 2/3 of the people in the audience, they're going to say that's BS. And then it takes 4 years before 90% say this made a difference in my life. And so you got to prepare people to be tenacious, because it doesn't happen quickly. And if it happened quickly, it would be superficial. So maybe just because this is figuring this out and how to make values manifest in day-to-day life is in fact a little tricky. There's a reason why religions do all the stuff they do, because it's hard. Yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor, thank you for a great presentation. My name is Irving Yee, I'm an MD MBA student at Vanderbilt. My thought and question for you is there's obviously behaviors out there. In your company, how do you deal with how do you motivate the 30% of your employees who aren't doing the chance, who aren't necessarily buying in, require a little bit more motivation, maybe their scorecards a little bit lower?
Yeah, because we'll never get to 100%. We're not. We have centers that are totally broken that are not village-like. So you have to accept that first of all. You're moving along a spectrum. It's not like it's not black and white. You're moving along a spectrum in terms of the breadth and depth of the penetration of this. For us, it's always try to refresh communication. Right? So you never give up, but you can't do things the same way every year. So you can't see the same commercial. First of all, the product's never going to work unless it's an authentic commercial that it says is true. I mean, let's just take that as a given. But second, you can't show the same commercial every year. So as a leader, you have to be continually searching for new ways to promote thought, website. Second is the systemization of a lot of rituals and practices. So we have, again, a tree filled with 30 different things that happen as a matter of course on an operating basis, just like having a monthly management meeting. We have a lot of village stuff that happens every month as a way of sort of refreshing it. And third, you relentlessly try to get better at that stuff of recruiting, reviewing, and reinforcing. So it's just like trying to drive inefficiency out of a factory. You got to bring that continuous improvement attitude towards it and a fresh outlook every bit. And then you recognize you're never going to get there because you can't get philosophically depressed when you run into somebody who says this is a bunch of crap and I think you're a lousy capitalistic boss. And in some cases, the executive levels, if they don't, after a time, sign up, then you ask them to go. At the senior levels, we used to, at the beginning, have a 2x2 matrix each year, business performance and mission and value performance. And now we don't because there's just no executive that survives unless they believe. But in the early years, we had to slowly transform or outplace any executive who didn't believe.
All right, there we go. Okay. So your talk focused a lot more on culture than on the other aspects of your corporate strategy, but my impression is that the rest of your corporate strategy is kind of an offshoot of your corporate culture. So I guess that's my first question, is that impression accurate? My second question is, do you feel that the healthcare industry is such that that is the right attitude for healthcare companies in general to have, that they should figure out their corporate culture first and then kind of build their strategy from there? Do you think that's something that should actually be practiced across industries?
Yeah, well, what we believe is that what we talk about has nothing to do with healthcare. We were running 2,000 Taco Bells. We would bring exactly the same stuff to it. Of course, the presence of the patient makes some things different, but 95% stays the same. It has to do with what kind of work environment, what is your implicit or explicit social contract with the people who are working their tails off, trying to pay their rent and deliver a good product in a meaningful way to the customer. So that's point one. Point two, nowhere of any village of any competence would ever forget the fact that unless the village has a healthy economy that's growing, they're toast. The thing doesn't work. The road to health is paid with good intentions. The village has to have an economy that's sustainable where you don't have the money to do this other stuff and attract new talent and the rest. And so you can't separate out and no mayor work, just like of course no public company CEO would, the economics, because no one's printing money to help me run my village. No one's printing money to help me run my company. A third, however, the final point is, when I was younger, my early years as a CEO, I was known as a lot of team building stuff. I was regarded as when I was at Maine, sure, good team builder, I loved it. But at that stage of my life, team building was the means, and greater business success was the end. It didn't make it insincere, but it was, I want to build a great team, and I'm able to sell our business, and roll over our clients, and then it was a public company, build a great team, and that'll drive more growth, and that'll lead the stock up. So the team building stuff, the bonding stuff was the means, and profit was the end. But nothing insincere about it, nothing immoral about it. And then as I got older and I came to Vita, it flipped for me. So now profit is the means. And having a differentiated impact on people's lives, my teammates' lives, and the world, not the patients, is the end. And of course, I know if we do all that, the patients will benefit immensely as they have. And it turns out a lot of the things you do are the same. And the texture and the robustness and the vitality and the depth of those things is way different once the ends and means. And I think a lot of business leaders forget that capitalism was chosen by society to serve society, that it was a good way for society to benefit, and not the other way around. It was not some sort of preordained love and commandment about how the economy should be managed. And if business leaders do not pay enough attention to their responsibilities with respect to keeping healthy communities, then those communities will change the rules more and more and more in ways that business doesn't. Because the business leaders forgot that the business's job, the economic system's job, is to serve society, not be somehow separate from it.
And you say have time for one more question?
There's something back there. I was wondering if I have set this aside somehow.
You talked
a little bit about our lab about the importance of reflection and self-knowledge. Can you tell us just a little bit about how you developed that self-knowledge and how you made time to reflect?
Yeah. Well, first is that we have a number of creative people here. I can tell you I'm a highly imperfect vehicle for this message. But I am the CEO and the mayor, so I am the vehicle. There are many in this room who are a better leader than I am. Very few in this room are a better student of leadership than I am. Because I've taken it very seriously for a long time, despite my limited ability perhaps to practice it. And I've had a lot of time on the saddle watching myself and others. So while I bow to many of you in terms of your ability as a leader, I bow to few as a student of leadership. What I do to try to bump my performance up in this regard as a human being is for me, number one, I do personal journaling. So once a week, I go on the six pillars of my life: right body, right thought, right family, right relationships, right work, right plan. They've changed a little bit over the years, some of the labels, but and I said I was thinking right to myself whether or not I'm living a life consistent with what I say I want my life to be. And you find I've it's very easy for me to lie to myself when I'm just thinking. I think when I'm driving along or sitting in the chair and say, I'm pretty good at it. And you got it right. You go, well, this is like the fourth week in a row that I'm not so questioned. So this is not just a bad week, it's a bad habit. So the personal journey is important for me. I also, for myself, Buddhist reading, I found that very learning. Third, what I found I had to do is I have a daily warrior's chant, not in the sense of war, but in the Buddhist sense of a warrior for mindful behavior. And I wrote my own, and I say it to myself virtually every morning as a way of trying to get me grounded, and often works for 6 or 7 minutes. So I do that virtually every day. Fourth, some of my behavioral faults. And when you get to be, I'm 54, when you get to be my age and you've been a CEO for a long time, you still got behavioral faults. That's not a casual thing. I mean, they're pretty deeply embedded. And so the notion that you're just going to get a 360 and have a significantly change and become less angry is false. Because at that point, you're 43 already. And so what I realized is that in the metaphor I use, the same way that an alcoholic takes it one day at a time, I started keeping a daily score of some of the things that came up about my behaviors in 360s. So I rate myself every night. And I kept a log, and my secretary kept it, of how did I perform that day? Because clearly I had a blind spot. Clearly in the intensity of day-to-day life, I would always regress to some bad behaviors. And only by scoring myself every day as opposed to once a year reflection could I start to change. And the good news is I have about 5 of them, as Steve and Mark and some others will test. And over the last 6 years, I've wiped out 2/3 of them. They no longer show up on my 360. And I think that day-to-day monitoring. And number 6, for me, I need quiet time. So I exercise 7 days a week, although I'm not awake until the AM. And I get my time where I go off and go backpack for a day, or be off in the woods for a good chunk of time. But I just need to be with myself, where it's very quiet, to confront the reality of myself. Otherwise, I go off track. So those are the 6 things that I do to try to contain my bad tendencies. I do want to say this is a great honor for us to get to speak to a group like this. I honor your potentiality. I know the kind of people that are in this room, and so I wish you absolutely the best in your life